Christ in Millvale, and thank you for being with us. A few weeks ago, when we were discussing what we might want to talk about, what we felt would be challenging, we brought up the idea of what is the most difficult parable that Jesus ever told. Now, I think it came down to two. It was the persistent widow and the shrewd manager, shrewd servant. And hands down, it's the shrewd servant. And so this is what we're going to talk about today. The shrewd manager. The reason that it's difficult is because we don't like it. You're probably familiar with the story. Jesus told a parable about a rich man, and he had a manager, and he realized the guy was cheating him, so he was going to fire him. The manager gets wind of this, and he decides, wow, I've got to do something because I don't really have skills. I don't know what I'm going to do. But he thinks it through, and he goes to all of the customers, and he says to a customer, as an example, you owe for 800 barrels of olive oil. I'm going to charge it for 4, and I'm going to keep the rest of the money. The customers were not gaining money or anything on this. It was the shrewd servant or shrewd manager who was getting away with this. And he went right down the line, and he would make up all of these invoices and take the money for himself. Eventually, his boss found out about it. His boss found out that he was still being dishonest, only it was worse than ever, and he was shrewdly taking advantage. And what the boss did was the unexpected thing. He commended him. He thought, oh, that's so smart. Well, that's so smart. You're so shrewd. That's what upsets us. That's what makes this parable, this story, a little bit infuriating. And then Jesus says to the disciples listening, I'll tell you, use worldly means to gain friends for yourselves, because when that's gone, you will be welcome into your eternal dwelling, eternal life, the kingdom. What he's saying is you can still be kind to people here. You don't have to be a thief. You can still get along with people here. But be generous. And the kindness that you receive is good, because we have a kindness and a goodness that is beyond that even. But then Jesus goes on. He says, whoever can be trusted with a little can be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with little will be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, how will you be trusted with true riches, spiritual riches even? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, why should you have any property of your own? No one can serve two masters, Jesus says. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and you'll despise the other. You cannot serve God and the world at the same time, meaning the riches, the superficiality of the world. Here's the next part. The Pharisees who loved money, they heard all of this and they were sneaking around, listening and sneering at Jesus. But he turned directly to them and he said, you are the ones who justify yourself in the eyes of others, but God knows your hearts. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight, meaning what they value highly, the fancy clothing and the authority and the money and all of those things, when they were supposed to be serving God and helping the people around them. And this is the word of the Lord. So what do you make of it? Do you see why it's kind of hard? Because it sounds in a way like Jesus is okaying this shrewd guy who's doing what's wrong. But then when we get into it a little bit more, we see there's more to the story. But I wanted to talk to you about something else. One of the things that we do when we read a story, when we read a parable, if you notice, it's the beginning, the middle, or the end of the parable. And what we call that is a pericope. That means that's the part that fits together. That's the perspective. So this particular parable is one pericope from the Bible. And what I always say is read what's before it and read what's after it. Because it's not just the words that go together, not just that narrative. It is part of a larger narrative that Jesus is telling, part of a larger view. So we have been reading from Luke 16, what goes before it? What do we read right before this story of the shrewd, sneaky manager? Well, it's a story of the prodigal son, one of the most beloved parables ever, about a young man who, much like this manager, got caught up in wanting the world, wanting the riches of the world, the way the world was. And it doesn't work out that way. And so he's broken, but he's afraid to come home. He eventually does. And when he does, his father runs out to meet him and greet him and love him and forgive him. Wonderful story. So that leads into this story. But then we go through this story. What comes after this story? The second story is that there's a rich man who was very wealthy and privileged. And at his gate, there was a beggar who was just so poor, so needy. A time came when the beggar passed away and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man then also died and was buried. And he was in Hades or hell. And when he was there, he was tormented. And he looked up and he saw Abraham. And who does he see beside him but the beggar he had ignored and treated very badly? His name happened to be Lazarus. And he was being treated very, very well. And so the wealthy man begs Abraham to allow Lazarus to bring him a drink of water. He's in agony. And Abraham says, "Son, remember that in your lifetime, you received those good things that you wanted so much. And Lazarus struggled. But now he's comforted here. And you're the one who's in need. And beside all this, there's a great chasm. And those who want to go from here to there cannot. You can't just cross over anytime you want to after you behaved the way you did." And so he answers, I beg you, send Lazarus to my family then, for I have five brothers, and let him warn them that they should be good, that this is a place of torment, that they should listen to what God told them." And again, Abraham replies, "Well, they have Moses and the prophets, and they didn't listen to them, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes, then maybe they'll listen." And Abraham said, "If they didn't listen to Moses and they didn't listen to the prophets and they didn't listen to others, they are not going to be convinced by someone who rises from the dead." That's the second story. Prodigal son, the shrewd manager, the man in hell. And he's also mentioned at that point in time, someone who rises from the dead. So we have, we who are reading it from our perspective, we see a little bit more maybe than those who were listening to it at the time when Jesus was telling the story. And so as we read this very complicated and difficult parable, I think one of the first questions we have to ask is, who was Jesus talking to when he's telling this parable? Well, I think first, of course, the disciples. They're learning about what's valuable in life and that what they've given up is nothing compared to the spiritual life that they're living, the opportunities that they have. And anyone who's lived long enough knows that being able to do good is its own reward, as they say. We have another story then about a wealthy man who dies. The thing about this is you can be very wealthy and you can be very good. Those things don't exclude each other. That wasn't even the point. But when he's talking to the man who's just been mean and not generous and not kind and not faithful, I think who he's talking to is the Pharisees. They've been sneaking around and listening. Jesus didn't address them at first, but then he turns and looks at them. And he calls them out for what they are, for who they are. They've been unkind to the people who they could care for. They've been the ones that prevented them from going into the temple unless they had enough money. And we see Jesus fighting for those people, which is important. I remember hearing a wonderful story by Elie Wiesel, and he was a survivor of the Holocaust. He was a young man when he was in a concentration camp, and he was with his father. And his father was one day kicked and knocked down and abused by a soldier. And his father didn't react. And Elie Wiesel, he wanted to react. He wanted to do something. And the father said, "Never forget this. I will always want to be the person here rather than the person behind that boot. I never want to be that unkind person." And I'll bet you feel exactly the same way. Exactly the same way. Listen, the world's hard. We're all going through a lot. And it hurts. We pray for the people that we love. We pray for those who we don't even know. And we pray that God looks down on everything that's going on and can move people to become kinder, better, because we know that's what God wants. Recently, my husband told me a wonderful story about a billionaire, and he was an art collector. And he collected all this art through all the years. And then when he passed away, they looked at the art and it was worthless because he wasn't very good at it. But that reminded me of another story. This is a little bit better. We live in the Pittsburgh area. And in our area, there is a wonderful museum, the Carnegie Museum of Art. Andrew Carnegie lived in Pittsburgh, the Westinghouse, Heinz's. So we have a lot of different opportunities to have libraries and art museums and things like that that were given or donated by industrialists of their day. Well, Carnegie really liked to collect art, as a lot of them did, and he filled his walls with art. There was a very wealthy, a very wise art collector and dealer. And I guess he saw pictures of the art that Carnegie was collecting. And he collected a lot of art. He had a lot of money, but he didn't have a lot of taste. Now, that's an individual thing. But so this art collector sort of put himself in a situation where he would meet Carnegie. They happened to be in Paris. And he took him to museums. And what he would do, rather than criticize, he would say, "Oh, that Rembrandt. Look at that Rembrandt, the way the light and the dark play in the painting. I know that's what you would love. Oh, you have such good taste. That's what you would love." And he went from place to place. And it was almost like he gave Carnegie art lessons, art history, art appreciation lessons. And Carnegie became more aware of the great art time, and he brought a lot of it back to Pittsburgh. He covered his walls with it. But the art dealer gave him another idea. He said, "You know, you've covered all your walls with this beautiful art. Wouldn't it be wonderful if people who never got an opportunity to see this got an opportunity to see it?" And so he created the Carnegie Museum of Art in my hometown. And he brought all the great paintings that maybe average people would never have the opportunity to see. And you might say, why would that be? Because God gives us beauty. God gives us creativity. God gives us joy. And that's part of what came with that. Now, this is a fun part of the story. A few weeks ago, my congregation, filled with wonderful people, surprised my husband and myself with a one-year subscription to the Carnegie Museum of Art. We can go anytime that we want to. We can go for just a little bit of a time. Ordinarily, you spend a whole day because, you know, you have to donate to get in, and just one of those things. But we can go anytime we want to. We can go to all the special exhibits. It reminded me the very first time I was even there as a young child, and I was just overcome by the beauty of the art. And it made me realize how much is possible. It made me experience the beauty of God's world. It's funny like that, isn't it? It's funny. Jesus tells us a story where it seems as though a bad man gets an advantage. But then he reminds us of what's important. He reminds us what's important. God's love. The beauty of our world. The kindness and generosity that we can give to one another. The hope that we have in the midst of anything that happens in the world. And we also have eternal life. So this may be the hardest parable of all, but I think maybe one line, one of the last lines of it, sums it up. Tell me what you think. Jesus said, God loves you. God knows your hearts. Whatever else is going on, God knows your hearts, and God loves you. Now, I think maybe that's more valuable than anything else on earth. What do you think? Thank you so much for spending this time with me today. I really, really appreciated it. Oh, it's so nice to talk to someone about the things that are important to us, isn't it? I also invite you to join us anytime, any Sunday, 10:45 in the morning, 425 North Avenue, Millvale, Pennsylvania. We'll be waiting there to give you a great big hello. If you come and join us, make sure you say hi. Make sure you say hi to me. But thanks for this time together, and God bless you. Amen.